make everything new. Jesus, one day you will bind every wound. The former things shall all pass away. No more tears. One day you'll make sense of it all. Jesus, one day every question resolved. Every anxious thought left behind. No more fear. And when we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. One day we will see face to face. Jesus, is there a greater vision of grace? And in a moment we shall be changed. On that day, and one day we'll be free, free indeed. Jesus, one day all the struggle will cease, yeah. And we will see your glory revealed. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. It's when we all get to heaven, a day of rejoicing that will be. And when we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Oh. One day, one day, we'll be singing loud. It's one day we will see face to face. Jesus, is there a greater vision of grace? And in a moment we shall be changed. In a moment we shall be changed. Yes, in a moment we shall be changed. On that day. And when we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Oh, we'll sing and shout the victory.
Well, good morning, everyone, and we give you a very warm welcome in the Saviour's precious name to this, our online broadcast brought to you again on behalf of the Fellowship of Kilkeel Baptist Tabernacle. Here we are, Lord's Day morning, the 19th of July in the year 2020, and we're online to worship and to glorify and to praise the Lord, who alone is worthy of all our praise and all our worship. And wherever you're tuning in from right now where you're sitting, it has been our prayer already, and it's still our prayer, that we all will know the blessing of God to our hearts this morning. And this morning God has given me a lovely message. I've called it Staying Strong in Times of Trouble. And that's the message God has for us this morning. We're going to the home of Marcus and Michelle Allen, where Marcus will bring to us our children's talk for the boys and girls this morning. And then we're heading over then to the home of Paul and Laura Morris, where Paul will read the scriptures for us. Now, before we go any further, we're going to worship the Lord together in the singing of our opening hymn this morning. It's called 10,000 Reasons. Isn't it true, child of God? It'll take more than 10,000 reasons. We've got more than 10,000 reasons. In fact, we've got 10,000 times 10,000 reasons why we should bless the Lord and offer him our sacrifice of praise. And then once we have this hymn, the words will be on the screen there for you. We'll be back for our opening prayer and for the continuance of our broadcast. Thank you.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy name, sing like never before, oh my soul, I'll worship your holy name.
The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning, it's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy name.
Time has come.
Soon my soul will sing your praise unending.
10,000 years and they're forever. See you.
that's what we want to do this morning. We really want to bless the Lord, for indeed, for the countless reasons, for all the blessings that he has bestowed upon us. Let us just still our hearts. Try and forget about everything this morning, child of God, and focus on the Lord now as we come to him in prayer. Remember, we come before one who hears and answers prayer. So let us, with that wonderful assurance that we had come before God now, as we pour our hearts out to him, that he will hear and answer our prayers. Let us pray together. Let us pray. O God, our loving and eternal Heavenly Father, we just take these moments together on this, the morning of thy day, just to still our hearts. And Lord, before we go any further, we just want to be still and to know this morning that thou art God. And Lord, we just worship thee this morning, that indeed, Lord, as we come before thee, we acknowledge thee to be the one true God that has made the heavens and the earth. And Lord, this morning, as we just come and bow ourselves at thy most holy feet, Lord, we're so grateful and we're so thankful this morning for every blessing that you bestow upon us. But Lord, this morning, as we sit still and as we listen, Lord, just to your voice, even now as we come to prayer, we thank you, Lord, indeed, for thy so great salvation that each and every one of us possess this morning. We thank you, Lord, indeed, for that day in our lives experience when we trusted the Savior, when you came to us in a very unique way, and Lord, you showed unto us our sin and our great need of the Lord Jesus Christ. And Lord, we do thank you this morning that it was in loving kindness Jesus came, my poor lost soul, to reclaim. And Lord, this morning, as we just bow before thee, Lord, we just worship and praise thee for the wonderful grace and love and mercy and faithfulness that you have towards us this morning. And Lord, today as we come before thee, we just pray, O God, that as we lay our hearts before thee, Lord, you know our different needs. Lord, you know all about our struggles this morning. Lord, you know all about our fears and our concerns and our anxieties. And Lord, we just pray that you will minister to our needs. Lord, today as we come together online, we just thank you, Lord, that you understand and you are being touched by the feelings of all our infirmities. And Lord, we just, as we continue on, that Lord, through your word this morning, that we will hear your voice. Today, Lord, we just thank you for the place which is called Calvary. Lord, today we thank you for all that, for what happened there. And especially, Lord, for the one who died there. We thank you, Lord, for the words of the Apostle Paul when he said, "But God commended his love towards us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." Lord, help us to really appreciate, to be really thankful for all that you've done for us in your love towards us. Today, Lord, as we just now, as we bow ourselves before thee, we just pray, Lord, for any this morning who are going through difficult times. We pray, Lord, you will meet them at the very point of their need. I want to pray this morning for every member of our fellowship in Kilkeel Baptist Tabernacle, every one of them, Lord, every friend, every adherent. And Lord, for all the needs of our fellowship, we just pray, Lord, that you will meet those needs. That in these uncertain days in which we live, and indeed with an uncertain future before us, we pray earnestly, Lord, that you will lead us and guide us in every way. And Lord, we just commit our our broadcast to thee this morning, that every part of our broadcast will be owned and blessed of God. Bless Marcus's children's talk this morning to the boys and girls. Pray, Lord, this morning that the boys and girls and every one of us would be enriched through it. Remember to Paul as he reads the scriptures to us. Even through the reading of the scriptures, Lord, may we hear your voice. And for your word to our hearts, bless us, Lord, and bless that word to each and every one of us. And may it be a blessing to every heart. And then, Lord, remember our time as we remember the Lord's death in his own appointed way. In the breaking of bread and in the drinking of the wine, Lord, will indeed you undertake him. And Lord, bring a fresh glimpse of Calvary back to us again. Then for our drive-in church this evening, we just pray, Lord, for the preaching of the gospel and for the singing of the gospel, that, Lord, you'll anoint both the singing and the preaching. Pray for George this morning, George Edgar, as he comes down to us this evening, that you'll give him journeying mercies, and that even, Lord, throughout this day, you will prepare hearts for the preaching of the gospel. That, Lord, indeed, in the car park tonight, there will be a turning away from sin and a turning to the Saviour, and that, Lord, even this night, will be a night marked for eternity and for the glory of God and the salvation of souls. So, Lord, continue with us now and bless us, we pray, in our Saviour's wonderful and precious name. Amen. Now, I just want at this stage to bring the necessary announcements to you. Please do remember, immediately after the message this morning, we believers, we wait to on and we keep tuned on to remember the Lord's death in his own appointed way. We continue the Lord's command in carrying out the Lord's command to remember his death in the breaking of bread. Then please do remember at 7 o'clock this evening, it's our drive-in church at the car park there behind Kilkeel Baptist Tabernacle. We would love to see you there. We would love to have you there. And we have George Edgar coming along this evening to minister in song. George is well known throughout the province and further afield in his ministry and song, and I know that you will be blessed. The message that I'm preaching on tonight, the message that God has given to me, I have called it Almost Saved, Almost Lost. And that's the message God has given to me this evening. So please do remember, pray much for the driving church tonight, that God would really speak and that God would save precious souls to the glory of his name. Then on Thursday night, we meet together in the tabernacle for our prayer meeting. And again, as I say, that's 8 o'clock. And can I encourage you, please, to come along and to join with us in prayer. If you're able to come along, please come along as we gather before the Lord. There will be social distancing in place. The 2-meter rule still stands and we still adhere to it. But we want to encourage you to come along as we seek God's face in prayer. Then next Lord's Day, 11:30, we're back on broadcast again in the morning, and then 7 o'clock in the evening, we're back to our drive-in church. And then just another announcement, our members have been notified already by letter and by email that from the 2nd of August, that's the first Lord's Day in August, we will commence our morning service at the car park of Kilkeel Baptist Tabernacle. And we want to move forward on this matter. Now, unfortunately, because of the size of our numbers and concerning the 2-meter rule, we would be unable to cater for everybody who wants to come along and worship with us. So we don't want to turn anybody away. And so what we're planning on doing and that is to meet together in the car park at 11:30. Can I encourage those of you who know and love the Lord to bring a piece of bread and a drink of juice with you. We will still be remembering the Lord, and we want to keep continuing to obey the Lord in this way. So please do remember that the 2nd of August, and there will be no break between the ministry and the breaking of bread. As soon as the ministry is over, then we'll be straight in to remember the Lord's death in his own appointed way. The pre-service prayer meetings will be as follows: 10:30 in the morning in the main tabernacle, and then 6:20 in the evening in the annex. And so we keep both places separate, just to keep the health and safety at bay. So please do remember that, pray much for us. There will still be children's talk as well. And please do get into the habit, if at all possible, if you're able, to come back out to fellowship with us on the Lord's Day morning. These are all the necessary announcements, and of course we make them subject to God's divine and sovereign will. Now, boys and girls, I hope you're ready there, because Marcus is going to bring to you this morning your children's talk, and then after Marcus, Paul will be along from his home to read to us the scriptures this morning. So it's over to you, Marcus, and I'll be back soon after Paul reads the scriptures. Thank you.
Thank you, George. Good morning, boys and girls. Thank you for joining us again this morning. Boys and girls, I want you to close your eyes for 2 seconds. Can you see any colour? Can you see any light? If I asked you to go across the room, would you find it difficult? Open your eyes again. Our story this morning is about a man called Bartimaeus. And the story is given in Mark chapter 10, verse 46 to 52. And what do you think of when you say someone is blind? What picture comes into your mind? Maybe it's of someone with a guide dog, or maybe a white stick, maybe an older gentleman. Maybe this is the picture you think about. Or maybe another image is somebody maybe as a professional with their suit going to work with their guide dog. Or maybe it's of a young person and maybe they're getting help but still have got their white stick. Well, our story this morning is about a blind man. And let's just set the scene. Jesus is travelling from outside Jericho, and he basically, go back one side of the map, he's travelling from Jericho to Jerusalem, and the distance between the two places is about 18 miles, and that's roughly the distance from Kilkee to Dundrum. So that's the idea of a distance of the journey that Jesus would have to make. And he sets out along a road, but it's not a road like we have with tarmac or with cement. It's really a dirt track, and it begins as a nice wide road that winds up high into the mountains. Well, this image is maybe more realistic of a blind man in Jesus' day. You can see here, he's probably sitting on the edge of the road, and you can see from his clothes, they're not very nice. They're really only rags, and he's maybe even got a begging bowl for people to put money or food into. And that's maybe a more realistic picture of a blind man in Jesus' day. Well, there actually was 2 blind men. So the other 2 Gospels in Matthew chapter 20 and Luke chapter 18 say that day there was actually 2 blind men. One of them being Bartimaeus. And Bartimaeus actually means the son of Timaeus. It's a little bit like McConnell or Robinson, where it implies it's the son of someone. Well, anyway, the 2 men couldn't see a crowd, but they heard with their ears, and they heard the noise and the commotion, and as the crowd approached, they asked someone in the crowd, "What's happening? What's going on?" And they asked who was there, and they were told that Jesus of Nazareth was coming down the road. Well, and that, the noise of the crowd made them aware of what was going on. And at that, they suddenly heard the noise and they cried out to the crowd. And they had asked what was happening. And they cried out, basically, "Jesus, the son of David, have mercy on us." Well, you know, the crowd turned round and said, "Be quiet, be quiet. Keep the commotion down." But, you know, the 2 blind men who were begging there that day, they shouted louder. They wanted to get Jesus' attention. They couldn't go to him. They wouldn't be able to find him in the crowd. And again, they replied, "Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on us." They relied, you know, as blind men on the generosity of others. And these men realized their desperate state. They couldn't gain employment. They couldn't do a useful job because they couldn't see. And it was only through the kindness of others that they could survive from day to day. Well, Jesus stopped when he heard the 2 men shouting. Some basically said, "Go at once into the crowd and bring them to me." And, you know, Bartimaeus got up at once and he left his blanket or coat. It just talks about a garment in the Bible. He left it behind in his urgency to get to see Jesus. Well, you know, The big question that Jesus asked was, what do you want me from me? And Bartimaeus replied straight away, Lord, that we might receive our sight. This implies that both men were blind from birth. They'd never seen colours of the rainbow. They'd never seen the green grass or tall trees. And they had been blind from birth. That was their big question. Well, Jesus had compassion on the two blind men. And this means that he saw their need, and in love he was compelled to act. Well, Jesus basically turned to the two men and he put his hands on their eyes, and you know, something amazing happened. He touched their eyes, and at once the two men could see. 20/20 vision, no blurring. They could see Jesus. They could see him face to face. And the first person they saw was Jesus. How wonderful that was. Their lives were transformed from that moment. They would no longer have to be led by others. They no longer would have to rely on others' generosity. They didn't have to feel their way about. You know, pleased was Bartimaeus, and he believed on Jesus. He said their faith had made them whole, that he followed. It says in the account, he followed Jesus on the road and the way. So what can we learn from this story? Well, the first thing is, do we recognise our own desperate, sinful condition? We need to realise that only God can help us. Like the two beggars, Bartimaeus being one of them, we need to recognise that only Jesus can help us. Only God can help us. And we need to leave behind our old sinful ways and come and ask God for mercy. Only Jesus, basically, can save us from our sins. He died on the cross and rose the third day so that we might have our sins forgiven. And he wants to transform us and transform our lives. And you know, like Bartimaeus, who instantly got his sight back, we can cry out to God and he immediately will forgive us for our sins and bring us into a useful service. He will restore us to the people that we should be. And we need to follow Jesus each day by reading our Bibles. We're also reminded by Jesus to see the needs of others in our daily lives, the people that we come into contact day by day. Do we greet them and treat them with kindness? I'm reminded lastly of a little story. And the story is about a blind man more recently, and he's out begging on the street, and he's got a piece of cardboard, and on that piece of cardboard is written, I'm blind, please help. And lots of people pass by, and very few actually put any money into his wee pot that he's collecting his money. And he hears a clip-clop of some high heels go by, and then what happens is the lady returns, and she asks for his card, and she picks up the piece of card and turns it round. And on the back, she writes, it's a beautiful day, and I can't see it. And the man didn't know what was written on the card, but the card was placed back down. And after that, lots of people gave more generously and gave more money. And he later asked what had been written on the piece of card. Are you grateful for God's daily blessings? The blessings of a home, of a family, and of food, and of all the things that God gives you, the ability to hear and to see and to taste and to run. And hopefully this story about Bartimaeus should make us grateful and pleased to worship and thank God for all his blessings. Thank you for listening, boys and girls. I'm just going to hand you over to Paul Morris, who's going to do the Bible reading.
He couldn't see the sun, he couldn't see the trees. Blind old Bartimaeus, he couldn't see. But Bartimaeus heard Jesus walking by. Jesus, he could help me. And so he cried, Jesus, Son of David, Jesus, please be kind. Jesus, Son of David, hear me, I am blind. The people all around called out as they passed by. and spoke, but Emmaus, you will see. I have healed your blindness, 'cause you trusted me. Jesus, Son of David, Jesus, he is kind. Jesus, Son of David, healed me, I was blind.
For the talk to the boys and girls. Our reading this morning is taken from Psalm chapter 3. Lord, how are they increased that trouble me? Many are they that rise up against me. Many there be which say of my soul, there is no help for him in God, Selah. But thou, O Lord, art a shield for me, my glory and the lifter up of mine head. I cried unto the Lord with my voice, and he heard me out of his holy hill, Selah. I laid me down and slept, I awaked, for the Lord sustained me. I will not be afraid of 10,000s of people that have set themselves against me round about. Arise, O Lord, save me, O my God, for thou hast smitten all mine enemies upon the cheekbone, thou hast broken the teeth of the ungodly. Salvation belongeth unto the Lord. Thy blessing is upon thy people, Selah. We trust the Lord and will bless the reading of his word to our hearts. We'll just pass it back to Pastor George.
Thank you very much indeed, Marcus, for your children's talk this morning, and also to you too, Paul, for reading the scriptures for us this morning. Thank you both. So much indeed, thank you. The Bible makes it clear, child of God, doesn't it, that nobody is exempt from troubles. In fact, the Bible has a lot to say to us concerning about God's people even expecting troubles. You know, child of God, this morning when we go through our Bible makes it very clear that none of us are exempt from trouble. You remember what the book of Job says in Job chapter 5 and verse number 7. It says, man is born unto trouble, as sure as the sparks fly upward. There's none of us this morning, child of God, you nor I, are exempt from troubles in any one way. Again, in the book of Job, we read Job 14 and verse 1. Man that is born of a woman is a few days and full of trouble. And right throughout the Bible, child of God, we learn that troubles are common to all men. Whether they are rich or poor, whether they are good or bad, even though they are saved or unsaved, troubles are indeed, they are common to all men. And you and I know, child of God, only too well that troubles can land onto our lives in 1,001 different ways. And yet, child of God, there are so many who teach and preach very foolish things. Some people would teach and preach that as long as you're saved and you come to know Christ as your Saviour, you'll never have troubles, you'll have never have worries, you'll never have struggles, you'll never be sick, you'll never be sorrowful. You and I only know too well, child of God, that is so untrue. And if the truth be told, some of us never knew problems and troubles until we got saved. You know, child of God, this morning, when you go through your Bible, you'll find many of the great characters of God. The great servants of God had their share of troubles too. You think of Elijah, a man who turned a nation back to God, And as soon as he turned the nation back to God, what happened? Then he ran for his life, and so he was so depressed, so downcast, he even prayed that God would take away his life. You remember of others, you think of Jonah. Even Jonah, after a great revival, prayed that the Lord too would take his life. He just felt that he couldn't face any more. You think of others, Job, you think of Jeremiah, you think of David, and all the faithful servants of God. They all teach us that none of us are exempt from trouble. They all had their discouragement. They all had their times of depression. They all had moments of being downcast. And indeed, in those places, they thought to themselves that they were completely defeated. Sometimes, child of God, troubles come so hard upon us at times. Sometimes we think that all is lost. We feel that there's no hope. We feel at times that when we step out of one trouble, we step into a dozen more. And if we take one step forward, we're taking three back. I wonder, is this you, child of God, this morning? You're discouraged. You're depressed. You're downcast. You feel that this present circumstance, this present situation, this present trouble that you're going through right now, you believe that all is lost. You feel this morning that there's no hope. Well, here's something that God wants to show you this morning through our Bible reading. And that is staying strong through times of trouble. It's one thing finding ourselves strong and getting strong, but child of God, it's staying strong. Now that's the thing. It's staying strong. It's maintaining our strength during such times. Sometimes, child of God, we believe we're strong, especially when life is going good and the waters are calm and there's nothing concerns or troubles us, until trouble comes. And then suddenly then we only discover how weak we really are. You see, child of God, this message this morning being brought to you from God himself through me, his servant, God wants to teach you in order how to stay strong in times of trouble. Just this week, I was in my own devotional times, I was reading a little story concerning a mother of a handicapped child. This is what she said. We would have called our daughter's handicap the greatest tragedy of our lives, if it were not for the fact that through it we came to know the Lord so much better. Words could not fully express our keen disappointment when our little girl failed to experience normal mental development. Yet her condition made us understand just a little bit better how our dear Saviour must feel when his children do not mature spiritually. She continues by saying, the Lord knows that heartaches and troubles, if properly accepted, will enrich our lives in a way that could not happen otherwise. Strengthened in the inner man, we came through our trials and troubles bigger and better Christians, and with a new and a brighter testimony. When we go through troublesome times, child of God, it's not answers that we need. Sometimes when troubles comes into our lives, we're searching for answers, failing to realize it's not answers we need in troublesome times at all. No. When troubled times come, it's not answers we need. It's It's God we need. Will you remember that, child of God? If you're going through troubles at this very moment in time, and you're searching for answers, listen, stop searching for your answers. It's not answers you need. It's God you need. Here in Psalm 3 this morning, the psalmist David faces perhaps what we could call the darkest hour of his life. This psalm this morning is written against the background of what we read in the second book of Samuel, chapter 15 and chapter number 16. As David writes this psalm, David's going through terrible times. It's not Saul who's hunting him now like a partridge in the mountains and seeking his life. No, not at all. It's worse than that. As David writes this psalm in the backdrop of 2 Samuel 15 and chapter 16, it's when Absalom, his own flesh and blood, is out to destroy him and to take the kingdom from him. And I want you to understand that as David writes this third psalm, you'll be able to understand the heartache and imagine the pain that David faces as his own flesh and blood, his own son, is out seeking to destroy him and to take the kingdom from him. He's fleeing from Absalom. And as we come to this psalm, David in this psalm shows us through his own experience how we too can stay strong in times of trouble. There's four lovely pictures that this psalm brings before us, and each picture has a different scene altogether. I want you to notice that in verse number one and verse number two, there is the enemy that is engaging. Did you notice in verse number one, as David looks upon the horizon, there is nothing but trouble ahead. As he looks upon the horizon, there is nothing, only trouble facing him. And maybe at this very moment, child of God, you're in the same position as David was. Maybe you're looking into a future and you're looking into a horizon and trouble seems to be ahead. And I want you to notice, first of all, the strength of the enemy in verse number one. Do you listen to him as he prays? Because that's how we find the psalmist in this psalm. He's in prayer. And he says this in his prayer, Lord, how are they increased that trouble me? And can you see, child of God, as David looks onto the horizon, the enemy that is engaging is getting larger and larger. David feels and David sees himself here in a no-win situation. He sees no way forward. It seems this morning that the enemy has the upper hand, that the enemy has an advantage in every way. And child of God, there's often those times when we feel the very same way. We feel this morning that when troubles come, we're out of our depth. It seems that these troubles brings us into a no-win situation that we'll never be able to move forward. You know, every hour as David looks on the horizon, every hour brings more and more against him. And child of God, I can see him, you know, as he looks on the horizon, every moment, every minute, every hour brings more and more and more against him. And friend, this morning, can you hear him? Lord, how are they increased that trouble me? Is this you, child of God, this morning? Are you facing a no-win situation? Whatever the circumstance may be, You're going through some time of trouble this morning. You cannot see a way out. You cannot see a way forward. Oh, friend, it seems this morning that the enemy has an upper hand on you. You feel this morning that he has such an advantage on you. The odds are piling up against you just the same way the odds were piling up against David as he looked into the horizon. Is this you, dear brother? Is this you, dear sister, this morning? You're facing a no-win situation and the enemy is engaging. Can you see the strength of the enemy this morning? I wonder this morning, what do you see on the horizon that haunts you? What trouble has come into your life? What trouble faces you this morning? Maybe you say to me, Pastor George, the trouble that I'm facing at this very moment is a kind of a troubles that I've never faced before. Oh, child of God, can you imagine this morning as David looks on the horizon and the enemy is increasing at every moment? And Absalom, his own flesh and blood, is leading the charge. He's leading the enemy. He's the one leading the enemy against David. David, oh, he can feel the hatred in his heart. He can see the fierceness on his face. He knows what Absalom is planning to do. He's planning to push him out of everything and to take over his kingdom. Oh, child of God, it's not a new thing for families to turn against you. It's not a new thing, child of God, for even a family to even hate you this morning. Oh, child of God, you may say to me, that's an awful strange thing to say, but it's so true, child of God. And friend, there's nothing more painful when your own flesh and blood turns against you, just as it happens here and to David. And then I want you to notice in verse 2, verse 1 you've got the strength of the enemy, but verse 2 you've got the scheming of the enemy, because it says in verse 2, many there be which say of my soul, there is no help for him in God. If you read 2 Samuel chapter 16 and verse number 8, you remember this: the enemy comes to David and he says to David, the Lord hath returned upon you all the blood that you've shed in the house of Saul, and the Lord hath delivered the kingdom into the hand of Absalom. You know, child of God, we need to be very, very careful. Why? Because you see, when times of trouble come and the enemy speaks, mind you, the enemy can be very, very subtle. He can be very convincing. And mind you, it's easy to believe the lie, because I'll tell you why, child of God. As the enemy speaks, he can be very convincing. You see, what happened here was the enemy was trying to tell David, listen, this is payback, David. David, you've lost it. This is where your kingdom's coming to an end. It's payback time. The Lord is teaching you this lesson, David. The Lord is paying you back for all that you've done to the house of Saul. And I wonder this morning, does some past sin haunt you? You're going through this trouble. And mind you, the old voice of the devil is coming along and he's saying, you know, God has forsaken you. You thought you got away with that sin that you did in your unsaved days. And God is now coming back at you. God is forsaking you. God has stepped back. He's forgetting about you. You see, this is how the enemy weakens us in times of trouble. He tries to get you to believe that there's no help in God. You see, friend, this was the scheming of the enemy in David's account. And it's still the scheming of the enemy in our day and generation. Have you ever heard the old enemy whispering into your mind, oh, you know, God's forgot about you. Forget about trusting in God. He has forsaken you. And you know, friend, that's when the enemy comes, when the chips are down. But please beware, child of God, won't you? Beware now, because the enemy, he can be so convincing that you nearly believe that God is forsaken and God is forgotten. But child of God, you and I know that we have the promise of God. I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. And no matter how hard the troubles may come, God is there and he'll never fail us. Thank God today when he comes and he brings up some past sin of a past day. Thank God that sin's under the blood. And I have the word of God to prove it, that he will remember it no more. And you know, friend, isn't that wonderful? The enemy that is engaging. And then I want you to notice in verse number 3 and 4, the hope that is honouring. Listen to what David said. David said, "But thou, O Lord, art a shield for me, my glory and the lifter up of mine head. I cried unto the Lord with my voice, and he heard me out of his holy hill." You see, child of God, nothing honours God more when we, his children, hope in him when all seems lost. Oh, nothing honours God more when we place our hope in him when times of trouble comes. Did you notice in verse 3, he hoped in the protection of God. "But thou, O Lord, art a shield for me." You know, Jeremiah, there's a lovely wee word that comes from him. Jeremiah 17 and verse 7, "Blessed is the man that trusteth in the Lord, whose hope the Lord is." Isn't that a lovely verse? Listen to it. "Blessed is the man that trusteth in the Lord, whose hope the Lord is." And Psalm 146 and verse 5 says, "Happy is he whose hope is in the Lord his God." You see, his hope is in the protection of God. And as he looks on the horizon and he sees Absalom and the great armies increasing that was coming against him, yet David began to see the unseen. Oh, get that, child of God. David began to see the unseen. Because you know what happened? David could see between him and the enemy, God was there. "But thou, O Lord, art a shield for me." Do you remember what God promised Abraham? In Genesis 15 verse 1, he says, "Fear not, Abram, fear not, for I am thy shield and thy exceeding great reward." Do you know, child of God, when all of this great enemy came against David, David saw the unseen. He did indeed. He could see that God had placed himself between them and him. Oh, child of God, what a God we have this morning. What a God we have that places himself between us and the ones that come against us. Isn't that wonderful, child of God? Do you know what David was able to do? David was able to do this. He was able to encourage himself through what he knew about God. Get that this morning, child of God, for that's an important lesson. David was able to encourage himself through what he knew about God. Isn't that lovely? You know, child of God, I've told my congregation a number of times the story, and it's worth telling again. During the awful days of the American Civil War, the Union cavalry had surrounded a Confederate camp. And as they surrounded the Confederate camp to attack it, then one of the Confederates came out as he was to do guard duty. And as he was standing outside the camp doing guard duty, he began to sing. But you know, friend, the Union cavalry told his men to take aim at this man on guard duty. And he says, "When I give you the command, I want you to shoot him and then attack the camp." But this Confederate guard began to sing. And he began to sing that hymn, Jesus, lover of my soul, let me to thy bosom fly. Just at that point, the commander of the Union cavalry men says, hold on a minute, men, put your gun down. Put your guns down, because this man's my brother in the Lord and we can't shoot him. You see, the Confederate captain at this time, or sorry, the Union cavalry captain, he was a Christian. And he said, because this Confederate man's also a Christian, we can't shoot him. Just take him away and look after him and protect him. But to cut the long story short, child of God, after the American Civil War, up in Washington, there was like a reconciliation function. At each table, three Confederates and three Union cavalry men sat together and shared each story. One of the Confederate men said to one of his other men, Joe, his name was Joe, get you up to sing there, Joe, and let us show these Union men how well we can sing. So Joe, this guy Joe, gets up to sing. And what did he sing? He sung this song, Jesus, lover of my soul, let me to thy bosom fly. And you know, the captain of the Union Army was in that meeting as well at that function too. And he heard this man Joe sing at him. And his mind went away back to that night when he'd surrounded the camp. After Joe had finished, the Union cavalry man went to him and said, excuse me, sir, were you at such and such a place on such and such a night when your camp was attacked? That's right, I was. He says, you know, I was there on the other side and we were about to shoot you. And then this man, we heard you sing, and I said to my men, put them guns down. We can't shoot this man. He's my brother in the Lord and we can't shoot him even though he's on the other side. Joe, this Confederate guard who was on duty that night, said, that night, you know, I knew something was going on. Oh, he says, I knew you were there. I did indeed. But there's one thing else I knew. What was that? Said the captain. I knew that between you and me, there was God, and nothing was going to harm me. Isn't that wonderful, child of God? And that's what David knew. That's what David knew here in Psalm 3. He knew that God had placed himself between him and the enemy. You see, his hope was in the protection of God. But if you notice verse 4, his hope was in praying to God. Because in verse 4 he said, I cried unto the Lord with my voice, and he heard me out of his holy hill. Oh, child of God, never forget the words of Jeremiah 33 and 3, won't you? What do they say? Call upon me in the day of trouble, and I will show thee great and mighty things, which thou knowest not. Oh, child of God, isn't that wonderful? Isn't it wonderful we have a God who hears and answers prayer? You know, child of God, praying to God is not about praying long and praying fancy. Not at all. That's only showing off. Praying to God means pouring your heart out to God. Oh, friend, just telling God what's in your heart. You know, during the First World War, Duncan Campbell was riding on horseback as he was making a charge across some open ground. A soldier's, an enemy's bullet hit him and Duncan Campbell fell to the ground. He fell in amongst the mud and blood of that scene. Oh, it was an awful scene. And Duncan Campbell fell to the ground. As he fell to the ground, lying there in the mud, and feeling the blood oozing out of his body, he says, how can I die here alone with nobody else around me? You know what Duncan Campbell said he did? He cried unto the Lord. He says, Lord, I know you're here. And if you, Lord, hear my cry, Lord, send someone back to get me. Well, Duncan Campbell said he knew that God answered prayer, but he wasn't so sure whether he was going to answer that one. Within minutes, as Duncan Campbell's blood was oozing out of his body, knowing that he was beginning to feel cold and weak, all of a sudden, he heard the thunder of horse hoofs coming in his direction. He turned round and was managed to turn round. And there he was. He saw one of his own men coming and getting down and putting on his horse. Duncan Campbell said to the rider, He says, tell me this, who told you to come back from me? He says, I don't know. But he says, something within me says, go back, go back. There's a wounded man that you must pick up. Duncan Campbell said that day, as I was lying in the mud, God heard my simple cry. And you know, child of God, he can hear your cry too, you know. And he can hear my cry. And listen, many a time he heard my cry too. And this is how, child of God, we stay strong in times of trouble. We need to know enough about God in order to maintain our strength in days of trouble. And then I want you to notice thirdly, the calmness that was crowning. Because in verse number 5 and 6 we read these words here. I laid me down and slept. I awaked, and the Lord sustained me. I will not be afraid of 10,000s of people that have set themselves round about me. You know, as David looked in the horizon, and he sees God has placed himself between him and them, you know, suddenly David became to be calm. Do you remember Peter in Acts chapter 12 in the prison? He knew that Herod was going to take the head off him the next morning, but all through the night, David slept. Oh, he slept like a log. Why? Because you see, he knew that the Lord Jesus made him a promise that he would not die young, but he would die old. You know, child of God, Peter himself went to sleep that night, not on a pillow. He went to sleep on that promise. You see, David understood this, that the God who shields me is the God who sustains me. In Psalm 18, verse 18, we read, they prevented me in the day of my calamity, but the Lord was my stay. As I've said before, and I'm going to say it again, David knew enough about God to keep him strong. What about you, child of God? Do you know enough about God to keep you strong? What does Isaiah chapter 26 and verse 3 says? It says this, thou wilt keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on thee, because he trusteth in me. You see, child of God, if you settle yourself on, if you settle your mind on God, listen to this, if you settle your mind in God, then God will settle your mind. There's one for you. You take that this morning to heart. When you settle your mind on God, then God will settle your mind for you. Think of this, child of God. Think of this. My times are in thy hand. Why should we doubt or fear? Why? Because our Father's hand will never cause his child a needless tear. Do you see David here? Oh, the enemy is engaging. And because of this hope that is honouring, then there's this calmness that is crowning. And if you want, child of God, to stay strong in times of trouble, then you need to hope in God. Then you need to know enough about God to stay strong. And I think this is where a lot of Christians fail, child of God. This is where they lose ground. They don't know enough about God. You see, that's what God said to the prophet Hosea. My people are destroyed for the lack of knowledge. Child of God, young Christian, listen carefully. Get to know your God in these days. And if you get to know your God, you'll know what it is to be strong and to stay strong in times of trouble. And the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Notice here how David stayed strong in times of trouble. And then I want you to notice finally the assurance that is amazing. Oh, verse 7 and 8, listen to what he says. Arise, O Lord, save me, O my God, for thou hast smitten all mine enemies upon the cheekbone. Thou hast broken the teeth of the ungodly. Salvation belongeth unto the Lord. Thy blessing is upon thy people. Can you see this wonderful assurance this morning? Listen to David. Thou hast smitten. Thou hast smitten. Listen to it. Thou hast smitten all mine enemies upon the cheekbone. David had this assurance. God has already dealt with the enemy before the enemy has fired a shot. Isn't that wonderful, child of God? This was not an assurance of what God was going to do. This was an assurance of what God had already done. Thou hast smitten. God had the enemy already sorted out. Oh, child of God, what's your trouble this morning? What's worrying you? What's getting you down? What's annoying you this morning, child of God? Listen, turn it over to God. Your trouble may be bigger than you, but it's not bigger than God. God knows all about it, child of God. And in the day of trouble, we can still remain strong if we put our hope and our trust in God. In times of trouble, child of God, what I learned here from David this morning, in times of great trouble, God is still in control. And whatever, child of God, you're going through, whatever troubles you're facing, God is still in control. You know, God is always faithful. There's one thing, child of God, troubles will never change, and that's the faithfulness of God toward you and me. And here, from Psalm 3 this morning, God shows us and God enables us to stay strong in these times of trouble. Don't despair, child of God. Bring it to the Lord in prayer. And may God encourage you and enable you through this message to stay strong in your times of trouble. May God bless you on this message to your heart this morning. Now we're going to listen and sing together a lovely hymn before we come to the breaking of bread. The hymn that I have chosen this morning, just to finish off this message, is this lovely hymn, Great is Thy Faithfulness. What a faithful God we have, child of God, as we go through our times of trouble. We'll be back after to remember the Lord's death. God bless.
God, my Father, there is no shadow of turning with Thee. Thou changest not, Thy compassions, they fail not. As Thou hast been, Thou forever faithfulness, morning by morning, new mercies I see, and all I have needed, Thy hands hath provided. Great is Thy faithfulness, Lord. pardon for sin and a peace that endureth. Thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide. Strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine with 10,000. Faithfulness, Lord, every morning new mercies I see, and all I have needed thy hands hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. So faithful to me.
As we were listening to that hymn, Great is Thy Faithfulness, the Lord took the word great and placed it in my heart and brought me now to the very verse that I want to just meditate upon for a moment or two before we remember the Lord's death in his own appointed way. We come, of course, to that third verse in the second chapter of the Epistle to the Hebrews, where we read these words, so great salvation. They come, of course, from that great text that we often refer to in the Gospel. How shall we escape if we neglect so great salvation? But the writer to the Hebrews didn't describe it as salvation. He knew what he was writing about when he said, so great salvation. Brother and sister in Christ this morning, let's remember that you and I possess so great salvation. It's not just salvation, it's so great salvation. It's so great this morning that all the gold that you can mine from the world could never have purchased this salvation. The greatest scientists upon earth could never produce this salvation, because this is so great salvation. And as we come now to the Lord's table, let us just meditate as to why this salvation that we possess is so great salvation. Well, I think the first and on the top of the list, the reason why this is so great salvation is because it comes to us through so great a person. Acts of the Apostles, chapter 4, verse 12. Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given amongst men whereby we must be saved. This is why it's so great salvation this morning, because it comes to us through so great a person. Because this, of course, is the Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of God. The Son of God who became the Lamb of God to take away the sins of the world. You see, concerning the Lord Jesus, there was no so greater a person than him. Why? Because no other person walked on this earth without sin. Only the Lord Jesus was without sin. And what makes him so great a person is because there was no other good enough to pay the price for sin. He only could unlock the gate of heaven to let us in. Do you remember what he himself said? He says, "No man cometh unto the Father but by me." And this is so great salvation this morning because of this so great a person, the Lord Jesus. And then secondly, let's remember this. You and I possess so great salvation because it came to us at so great a price, didn't it? Do you remember last Lord's Day morning at the Lord's table, in whom we have redemption through his blood? What a price. Oh, child of God, no wonder this is so great salvation, because it came at so great a price. And you know, child of God, let's remember, it came to us through his blood. Not all the blood of goats on Jewish altars slain could give the guilty conscience peace or take away the stain, but the blood of Jesus Christ, God's Son, cleanseth us from all sin. Do you see, child of God? Can you begin to appreciate why this is so great salvation? Because it comes to us through so great a person. It comes to us through so great a price. But this so great salvation carries with it so great a pardon. Oh, child of God, think of what we read in this epistle this morning, chapter 10, 17 of Hebrews. Their sins and their iniquities will I remember no more. What a pardon, child of God. There's no pardon like this pardon. Even though we receive an earthly pardon from an ordinary earthly person, yet the remembrance of the sins that we inflicted against them, they're always there, they're always in the mind. This is so great salvation that we possess, because not only does it come to us through so great a person, through so great a price, but it carries with it so great a pardon. Because you see, our sins and iniquities this morning, they're under the blood. And as far as the east is from the west, so far hath he removed our transgressions from us. Child of God, as we come now around the Lord's table, in our homes, where we are, can you see why we possess so great salvation? Because it came to us through so great a person, through so great a price, and comes to us with so great a pardon. But let's not forget, Christ had to endure so great a punishment. Wounded for me, Jesus my Saviour was wounded for me. And let's get beyond man's wounds that was inflicted on the Lord Jesus. Let's get now to the real wounds, the wounds that God inflicted when he poured upon him his wrath as he bore our sins upon his own body on the tree. And child of God, nobody suffered like the Lord Jesus. Child of God, no punishment was ever meted out on anyone other than the Lord Jesus as he hung upon the cross. So great a punishment. So much so great that even the Lord Jesus cried, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?" And as we come to remember the Lord's death, in his own appointed way now, child of God, can you see why this is so great a salvation? Because we've come to remember this so great a person who paid this so great a price, who gave us to us this so great a pardon. who bore so great a punishment. And as we come now to remember the Lord, listen, child of God, let's be thankful, really thankful, for what the Lord has done for us on the cross at Calvary. Thank him, praise him, that we today through him and all that he's done for us obtain this so great salvation. Now let us still our hearts as we thank the Lord first of all for this bread that speaks to us of his body. And after we give thanks, we'll break the bread together. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for this bread that symbolically speaks to us of the Saviour's body that bore our sins upon the tree. The body that was broken, the body that was bruised, but Lord, the body that bore my guilt and shame. Accept of our thanks as we break this bread that speaks to us of the Saviour's body. Accept of our thanks as we do this in remembrance of him. Amen. The Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he brake it and said, Take, eat, for this is my body which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. Now, Lord, for this juice and for this wine that speaks to us symbolically of your precious blood, accept of our thanks, Lord, as we remember his blood that was shed that made this so great a price. Accept of our thanks, Lord, for the wine that speaks to us of the Saviour's precious, precious blood and our Saviour's name. Amen. And after the same manner also he took the cup. And when he had supped, saying, This cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as oft as ye drink it in remembrance of me. For as oft as ye eat this bread and drink this cup, ye do show the Lord's death till he come. Lord, this morning we could never find the words, the proper words, that would be adequate to use in order to thank you, Lord, for what you have done for us on the cross at Calvary. But Lord, we just want to thank you this morning for what we have in yourself. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for thy so great salvation, that it's eternal and indeed it's personal. And help us, Lord, as we go down through this week that is lying before us, to live lives that will glorify thy most holy name and indeed bear witness to thy saving grace in these lives of ours. Lord, now as we bring our broadcast to a close, bless us throughout the remainder of this day, for we pray in thy name, Lord Jesus. Amen and amen. Now, friends, thank you very much indeed for joining with us, and I trust and I pray that our broadcast this morning to you was a blessing and an encouragement to your heart. Please do remember the drive-in church tonight at 7 o'clock. We'd encourage you to make your way there if you're able to make your way there, but if you're living in a different country, well, we're not expecting you to fly over to us or drive a long distance, but you can tune in at 7 o'clock for a drive-in service. Now, because of what we've learned this morning about times of trouble and how we can stay strong, isn't it because he lives, child of God, we can face tomorrow with all its problems and with all its troubles? And that's how we're going to close the broadcast this morning. We're going to bring that hymn before you. Because he lives, we can face tomorrow. God bless you. And we'll see you at 7 p.m. this evening. God bless. Thank you.
It's not just about the manger where the baby lay. It's not all about the angels who sang for him that day. It's not all about the shepherds on the bright and shining star. It's not all about the wise men who traveled from afar. It's about the cross. It's about my sin. It's about how Jesus came to be born once so that we could be born again. It's about the stone that was rolled away so that you and I could have real life someday. It's about the cross. Not just about the good things in this life I've done. It's not all about the treasures or the trophies that I've won. It's not about the righteousness that I find within. It's all about His precious blood that saved me. The cross. It's about my sin. It's about how Jesus came to be born once so that we could be born again. It's about the stone that was rolled away so that you and I could have real life someday. It's about the cross.
It's about the cross.
It's about
the heat.